Good evening, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank the organizer for inviting me to give a talk today. So this is my last topic. The title is New HIV Drugs in the Pipeline for Treatment and Prevention of HIV. Another thing I would like to introduce myself. My name is Sasi Sopin Piyamanakul. I'm a professor of internal medicine from Department of Medicine, Faculty of Medicine, Ramathibodi Hospital, Mahidol University, Bangkok, Thailand. This is my disclosure. For today's topic, I'm going to cover three small sessions. The first one is current antiretroviral drugs, followed by new HIV drug in the pipeline for treatment and also for prevention. You can see that this is all HIV drug list that approved by US FDA. Right now, we have 8 classes of antiretroviral drugs, and we have 2 new classes. One is a post-attachment inhibitor, and the other one is GP120 attachment inhibitor. The other two next slide, I will show the 4 drugs that recently approved antiretroviral drugs in the US. For this table, this is the 2 drugs belong to the old classes of antiretroviral drug that we have. The first one is dalavirin that approved in 2018. It belongs to NNRTI class. Dalavirin has with single tablet and also in fixed dose combination. The approval indication is treatment naive HIV patients and also for switching for one who with no resistance of treatment failure and no known resistance to dalavirin. The other one is cabotegravir. This is an integrase inhibitor. It just approved in 2021. Cabotegravir has a tablet formulation and also intramuscular injections. The indication for cabotegravir is a combination with rilpivirine for treatment of HIV patients, adults who are virologically suppressed with no history of treatment failure and no known suspect resistance to cabotegravir and rilpivirine. And the other update indication is for cabotegravir is used in at-risk adult and adolescent with more than 35 kilo for PrEP or pre-exposure prophylaxis. This table shows another 2 drugs that belong to new classes of antiretroviral drugs. The first one called ibalizumab. Actually, it's approved in 2018. It belongs to CD4 post-attachment inhibitor. It is intravenous drug use. The other one called fostemsavir is approved in 2020, and it belongs to GP120 attachment inhibitor. Fostemsavir is an oral formulation. However, these 2 drugs, the approved indication is just for heavily treatment experienced HIV patients who have multi-drug resistant HIV infections. This figure shows the life cycle of HIV and also the HIV pipeline in 2021 and beyond. The life cycle shows 8 steps in HIV life cycle. We start with HIV attached to CD4 cell and through the last step that new virion production. For my topic today, I will focus on NRTTI or islatravir and capsid inhibitor or lenacapavir, maturation inhibitor GSK254, and I will touch a little bit on monoclonal antibody. I'd like to start with islatravir or MK8591. This is a novel NRTTI, or we call nucleoside reverse transcriptase translocation inhibitor. Islatravir inhibits viral replication via multiple mechanisms. The first one called translocation inhibition. Translocation inhibition prevents opening of the reverse transcriptase nucleotide binding site. And the second mechanism called delay chain termination. Islatravir changes viral DNA structure, such as nucleotide incorporated is prevention. So both mechanisms cause virus inhibit virus replication. Islasavir has very long intracellular half-life, so allow for low dose, very low dose options. And compared to available NRTI, MK85, 91 triphosphate, IC50 for HBV1 is more than fourfold lower, so it increases potency against most resistant strain. This is a study PO11 among naive people living with HIV, focused on islatravir plus doravirine. This is an international randomized double-blind phase 2B trial, include treatment naive patients and randomized into four groups. The first three groups in part one is a three drug dose ranging of islatravir from zero. You can see at very, very low dose per day. This is only 0.25 milligrams and 0.75 and 2.25 milligram per day. For part one, is it three drug plus another two is doravirine and 3TC. Compared to the fourth group is doravirine, 3TC, and tenofovir. So if the patient has HIV and A less than 50 at week 20 without vesicle failure, so then we go on to part two. So part two, 3TC will be discontinued. So only islatravir plus doravirine will continue to part two and continue to part three with maintenance phase. The dose, the selected dose of islatravir is 0.75. So this is a report, an update reported of the result at week 144. The result of week 96 was reported in Glasgow 2020. It showed that there is a high rate of efficacy and tolerability. No patient meet clinical for resistant testing. The update data of week 144 presented in European AIDS Conference 2021. And you can see the blue, dark blue graph here. This is a combined group of islatravir plus doravirine. And the gray bar show the result of dolutegravir, 3TC, and tenofovir. And you can see that 72% and 77% of the participants had HIV and A less than 50 at week 144. There is 7 patients had protocol-defined vesicle failure, but all discontinued trial with confirmed primary HIV and A less than 80, and no instance of clinical significant confirmed viremia or vesicle resistance. For safety outcome to week 144, and you can see the two row, two column here, in combined islatravir and doravirine group, only 8% of the patients had drug-related adverse event, compared to almost 23% of the patients among doravirine, 3TC, and TDF had drug-related adverse events. Most common drug-related adverse event is diarrhea, nausea, headache, and abnormal dreams. All discontinuation due to drug-related AE occur prior to week 48. There is no death, no severe drug adverse events across islatravir plus doravirine groups. MSD or Merck also developed right now for fixed dose combination of doravirine and islatravir in the single tablet regimen, and two study of switching is going to be conducted. The first trial is phase 3 illuminated switch A trial, and the other one is phase 3 illuminate switch B trial. Both trial is switching study from the previous regimen to doravirine and islatravir in combination one tablet a day. So we will wait for this result. For switch B trial, they switch from big tab to doravirine and islatravir. The study of doravirine islatravir also have in treatment experience patient, in heavy treatment experience patient. This is a study design of randomized double-blind study among patients who had a resistance, at least triple class resistance with one or less fully active antiretroviral remaining. The patient will randomize into four groups during the 7 days as a lead-in period. The first one will add islatravir in the failing regimen. The second group will add doravirine in the failing regimen. And the third group will add both drugs, doravirine plus islatravir in the failing regimen. And the first group adding a placebo. So let's move to the second drug called lenacapavir or GS 6207. Lenacapavir is a first-in-class selective HBV1 capsid protein inhibitor, and it's supposed to be a very potent antiretroviral drug due to multiple steps of HBV inhibition. So lenacapavir inhibits capsid disassembly and nuclear transport, and also inhibit virus production, and the last step inhibit capsid assembly. Lenacapavir has two formulations. The first one is oral, and the second one is subcutaneous. For oral formulation, being dosed it once yearly, once weekly is quite interesting. And for subcutaneous formulations, being dosed every 6 months, so it's very, very long. And lenacapavir have data that they fully active against major resistant mutation, include K65R, M184V, K103N, Q148R, and N155H. Capella study is a phase 2-3 lenacapavir in heavy treatment experience people living with HIV. This study allow the patient who document resistance to two or more agents from three or more four major antiretroviral class with less than two or two fully active agents. The patient will randomize into 2-to-1 ratio. The first group will receive lenacapavir oral for lead-in for 2 weeks, and then continue with lenacapavir subcutaneously every 6 months. And the second group, the patient will add placebo for the first 2 weeks, and then follow while lead in with oral lenacapavir and follow while lenacapavir subcutaneously every 6 months. So at pre-randomization screening, if the patient have HBV RNA less than 400 or decline more than 0.5 log copy, since initial screening, they will go to unrandomized cohort. So they will start with lenacapavir oral lead-in and followed by lenacapavir subcutaneous every 6 months. The primary endpoint is reduction in HIV RNA 0.5 or more at day 15. This graph shows the proportion of participants on functional monotherapy during 2 weeks with decline HIV RNA 0.5 or more at day 15. And you can see that the participant in lenacapavir group has 88% for viral load decline 0.5 log or more compared to placebo, which is only 15%. The right hand side graph shows the mean change of HIV RNA by visit. You can see the blue line here present the change in HIV RNA in lenacapavir group. So the change is about 1.9 log compared to 0.3 log. There is a statistical significant difference at day 15. This is the update study just presented in IAS 20 and 21. This is lenacapavir efficacy in randomized cohort at week 26. So the patient here is just only 36 patients. So by FDA snapshot analysis at week 26, 80% had undetectable or viral load less than 50 at week 26 in lenacapavir group. But almost 90 if we analysis of HIV RNA less than 200. So this graph shows the efficacy by number of fully active agents in optimized background regimen. So you can see that if the patient has no any fully active agent, 67% of the patient have HIV and AIDS less than 50. Of course, if the patient have a more number of fully active agents, the higher efficacy you can see at 86 and 81 here. How about the change of CD4 cell count through week 26? You can see the CD4 increased about 81 cells during 26 period in lenacapavir group. Another study called Calibrate study. This is lenacapavir for treatment naive people living with HIV. This is a randomized open label phase 2 trial. Patient naive patient adult with HIV and A more than 200 will randomize into 4 groups. The first 2 groups will receive lenacapavir subcutaneously every 6 months, and the analysis will do at week 16 and week 22. If HIV and A is less than 50, the patient the drug will switch to TAF or BIC and to maintenance phase. For the third group, the patient will receive lenacapavir oral 50 mg OD plus FTC and TAF. And the third, the fourth group, the patient will receive BIC TAF regimen. So the primary outcome is the proportion of patients who have HIV and A less than 50 at week 54. This is an interim analysis of vertical outcome at week 28 from Calibrate study. Overall, across all lenacapavir arm, 94% of the patients can achieve HIV and AIDS less than 50. You can see the table here. The patient in big TAF group, 100% of the patient has HIV and AIDS less than 50. And there is no lenacapavir resistant associated mutation detected in baseline sample. The next new drug in the pipeline called GSK, for short we call GSK253. This is an investigational next generation HIV-1 maturation inhibitor. Maturation inhibitor will work late in replication cycle to block the cleavage of GAG P25 into P24 capsid and spacer peptide 1. So it results in various non-infectious variant. You can see of the figure here. Yeah, this is an immature virus compared to mature virus the above here. From phase 1 study in healthy volunteer found that the treatment was well tolerated with PK supportive of QD or once daily and unboosting dosing. This figure shows the phase 2A study of GSK253-254 study design. It's just a very small sample size, only 14 patients, naive patients, was enrolled in part 1 with GSK254 of a dose 210 mg compared to placebo. And for part 2, there is 20 HIV naive patients enrolled to 4 groups. With a different dose of GSK254. The dose are 40, 80, and 140 milligrams compared to placebo. And the primary endpoint is maximum change of HIV and A versus day 1 during part 1 and part 2 study. This graph shows the change of HIV and A from baseline. And you can see for part 1, there's only 2 doses, 210 milligrams. And you can see that the maximum HIV and A change from baseline from past one is approximately 2 log in day 11. And for part 2, at day 8, the maximum change of HIV and A in 140 milligram here, and the mean change is around 1.5 log. So for the conclusion of phase 2 study of GSK254, the study is a bit dose and anti-inhibitory response relationship. There is no safety or tolerability concern with no adverse effect leading to drug discontinuation. For dose proportional PK was generally observed across 10 to 200 mg dose ranging. and from part 1 and part 2 140 milligrams and 200 milligrams dose demonstrated greater decline in plasma HIV RNAs. So the result of this study supported the ongoing phase 2b study evaluated safety and efficacy of dose response of GSK254 in combination with two NRTI for treatment naive patients. So let's move to the prevention, HIV prevention research and development and implementation. What do we have now? So currently, we have treatment in HIV patients or treatment as prevention. We have condom. We have both male and female condom. We have male circumcision. We have a saline exchange program for intravenous drug user. We also have PrEP, both daily oral PrEP or on-demand PrEP. So we have two pending or in regulatory review. The first one is dapivirine vaginal ring. The other one is long-acting injection or cabotegravir that waiting for approval for, just approved for 2 months for PrEP. How about in development of clinical efficacy underway? We have other drugs, long-acting injection for PrEP. We have developed a preventive vaccine. We have a long-acting oral PrEP, such as once a month. We also have oral PrEP and oral contraceptive combination. In development, preclinical and clinical, we have implantation that we're going to present here. And we also have a multi-purpose vaginal ring. We have body neutralization and child body, and also long-acting vaginal ring. If you see the website of National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Disease, NIAID now is funding research on 4 types of long-acting HIV prevention. The first one is intravaginal ring, followed by implantation, followed by injection, and the last one is monoclonal antibody. This is oral islatravir, as you remember that for the treatment HIV patients, they use a very, very low dose, that like less than 1 milligram per day. For prevention, they develop long-acting oral and islatravir. So the figure here shows the summary of phase 2A and phase 3 study of oral islatravir for prevention. The first one, phase 2 study, is double-blind placebo-controlled trial for 1 monthly oral islatravir. So the dose is increased to 60 milligrams and 120 milligrams in person at low risk of HIV infection. Right now, the study is ongoing, but no serious adverse event reported. The other study is phase 3 study of 1 monthly oral islatravir 60 milligram in high risk HIV infection. The study called Empower 22 and Empower 24 for oral islatravir compared to FTC and TDF in cisgender women. And for Empower 24, islatravir compared to FTC TDF or FTC TAF in men and transgender women who have sex with men. Another interesting prevention study is lenacapavir subcutaneous twice yearly. So I mean like every 6 months for PrEP. Right now we have phase 2 trial. This is a randomized double-blind placebo control trial called Purpose 1 and Purpose 2 study. For Purpose 1 study, the regimen will lead in with lenacapavir oral and then subcutaneously every 26 weeks. Compare lenacapavir to FTC TAF versus FTC TDF. The population is cisgender adolescent girl and young women. For Purpose 2, lenacapavir will lead in with oral and then subcutaneously every 26 weeks. Compared to FTC and TDF, the population is cisgender men, transgender women, transgender men, and gender non-binary people who have sex with partner assigned male at birth. Another issue is quite interesting. This is a new delivery system. It's called subdermal implantation. This is a protocol OOS phase 1 clinical trial of islatravir eluting subdermal implantation. This is a double blind placebo controlled trial of next generation islatravir. This is you can see the figure here, and the use of the same applicator as currently approved etanercept implant, and the figure here. So the phase 1 study is a subdermal implant contain 48 milligram, 52 or 56 islatravir placed in upper arm of non-dominant hand for 12 weeks. And you can see the level in red, in green, and in blue line here. The level of islatravir can be above of the PK threshold here for prevention. And for 56 milligram of islatravir implant project to release sufficient drug to maintain islatravir triphosphate level to above PK threshold for more than 52 weeks. And for implant site adverse event found in 61%, all are mild and moderate. How about multi-purpose prevention technology? There are many trials developed here. You can see, for example, like vaginal rings, vaginal and rectal gels, fast dissolving vaginal insert, vaginal film, and oral tablet. And you can see the prevention indication here. Both can prevent HIV and pregnancy, and some can prevent HIV and other transmitted diseases such as herpes, simplex virus, or HPV. And we can wait and see for these multi-purpose prevention technologies in the future. The last one is broad neutralization antibody. You can see the figure here. There is many neutralizing antibody developed in clinical trials. The mode of action of a neutralizing antibody is interfere the binding of HIV via envelope to human host receptor protein CD4. At least one clinical trial published in New England Journal last year. This is VRC01. This is a two big randomized trial in the same study. The one study conducted in sub-Saharan Africa among women. The other study conducted in America and Europe in MSM and transgender women. The patient will randomize into three arms, which is a high dose, a low dose, high dose, and placebo, with 10 infusions every 8 weeks. You can see the pooled clinical analysis here for prevention efficacy. For pooled efficacy, it's quite disappointed. The efficacy is just only 18%, and 95 confidence interval is minus 12 to 40. So the result of VRC01 is not interesting, but if we do sub-analysis in sensitive virus, so if we do see the graph here and specify the sensitive virus with has IC80 less than 0.3, and the analysis say that the preventive efficacy for sensitive virus is about 80%. So we will have to wait for another study and another proof of concept of monoclonal antibody for prevention of HIV. For summary, HIV drug pipeline, three main research-based drug companies, Gilead, Merck, and Viv, all are focused on simplified antiretroviral therapy. And all these three companies had current or planned dual regimens, and also long-acting compound in new drug classes. Many of the pipeline compound have the potential to be used for both treatment and prevention. Much of the current pipeline come from new drug classes that could be used for people who are treatment naive, treatment experienced, and with multi-drug resistant HIV. But the research challenge are more effective and tolerability treatment that we need, affordable, and also participant in study reflect demographic of global HIV populations. So thank you for your attention.